Before we start, going into conversation, I first of all, it's great to hear from you again. And how are you?
Fine. It's been a pretty quiet few months here. We live a very quiet, isolated life anyway. And here in the inland Northwest, we already had social distancing. It's called being ornery. So the pandemic really didn't affect us that much. And of course, we were very well stocked and very self-sufficient. So it was just a matter of making fewer trips to town.
Okay, excellent, excellent. Just briefly refreshing you, this is our third time, and we live out in the rural areas and the farm countries of the Dominican Republic, where I'm talking to you from now. And
right.
Much the same as yourselves, all we need is rain, pretty much. We're pretty much on a self-sufficient basis as it is.
You know, there in the DR, you can put a stick in the ground and it'll grow a tree, so...
Yeah, pretty much. Piñones, that's what we have all around the cow areas by our place, exactly. But you know what? 5 years ago, I first met you, and it was through your blog, a survival blog. And why we're even talking again, besides it being a pleasure, is since the lockdown, there must have been at least 10 or 12 of your subscribers through those past two videos that reached out to me and reminded me about it. Because truthfully, I forgot as well, Jim. I've read some of your books, and I enjoy them. But look, since 1984, we've been living like this, so this is, we were so far ahead of the curve, I mean, we didn't even need the brake pedal. And the way it is that reminded me about our other conversations about in 2015 when I actually surprised a lot of your subscribers. We had a tremendous amount of, comments afterwards, and by them reaching back, this 10 or 12 from you, half of them laughed at it, and they said, you know what? After 5 years later, you predicted this, and you predicted it in the first half of 2020. What the heck is going on? You did it with the dollar. You did it with the violence. You did it where the violence would be. You did it in terms of where things are standing now, gold, silver, when everybody else was way out to lunch. And we had a meeting before Trump, our second meeting that we both spoke for almost an hour between Trump and Clinton on where things would go, depending on who won the election.
Well, I do a lot of interviews, and I don't go on record as making a lot of predictions. But if you look at the introduction to my first nonfiction book, How to Survive the End of the World as We Know It, I talked a lot about a pandemic, and basically an influenza pandemic. And I don't claim to have a crystal ball. I just draw reasonable extrapolations from current events. And I think that it's wise to be well prepared. And if you can't see the fragility of society, I've got to say to your listeners, wake up, because the signs of fragility are all around us. And the recent events, namely the pandemic, supply chain disruptions, and everything else, have all really altogether pointed out that we're not in a stable situation geopolitically and economically, and in terms of just sheer logistics, we are living in a tinderbox.
Yeah, point taken, but there's a huge difference between predictions and apophatic research. That there's something to be said about that, because what we do is, and what I've always done my whole life, going on 63 now, the reason why we catch things so ahead of the curve on that, and where we know things are going in the next little while too, is simply because of coming from an unbiased point and just four people in our group. We call ourselves the mentors. We've been together for about 35 years, and each of us in our strengths bring together, and we form an unbiased conclusion. What was his name? Sherlock Holmes never found who committed the crime, but he eliminated everybody else who could not be. And regardless of his personal opinion, if the key unlocked every door and it's the last man standing, that's where it is.
Yeah.
And I just, I wanted to get a little bit from you maybe, where you see, and I'm so glad we're doing more of a fireside chat than simple questions, because, my gosh, some great people I've been talking with over the short period of time, and since this lockdown, So many people have been reaching out to me. It's incredible. But we're moving the key on, because if people can't see it by now, don't you think they're stuck in fear and they're choosing not to? Because, fear shuts down, rational thinking to quite a degree.
Well, yeah, so does normalcy bias, and so does just the desire to block out the ill effects of current events, and people wishing that they were still living in prosperity and freedom when they aren't. We're living in the age of deception and betrayal. And we see that so much in our mass media, in politics, and also just socially. The social trends that are coming to fruition right now really are quite alarming. I believe that just like survival blog readers, your listeners have probably gotten a good appreciation of the fragility of society, the importance of being proactive, the key concepts like strategic relocation in the midst of these kind of events. Because if people haven't caught on, they need to realize at this point time is short, because the window of opportunity to be making a major move may soon close.
You know, I remember, even though it was a long time ago, your reaction to my final question to you when I first met you. And that was, when it's all the truth comes out, because in the future it always does, what will you tell your grandchildren when they know this all could have been prevented and we did nothing to do it? And you said, whoa, that's pretty heavy. And eventually, we're going to have to answer that question, those of us who do have children.
Yeah, because people are making investing decisions and lifestyle decisions, really, that are shortchanging their own progeny. I can't look across the dinner table at my kids and say, sorry, kids, the world's falling apart. There's nothing on the supermarket shelves. And I decided I really wanted to take a vacation in Tahiti, or I really needed that HD television with the 74-inch screen, or I really needed a new jet ski instead of buying storage food, or instead of getting a second passport, or whatever. You know, that there's a lot of decisions that people make. Sometimes they're active decisions, sometimes they're passive decisions. Sometimes just the decision to do nothing is a decision.
You know, in the past 12 years, the over 100 families we've helped relocate to various countries, you know what? We've gotten a lot of attaboys about where they are right now. A lot of them are taking part in things like you and I do in terms of growing their own. For the family, chickens, some hens, guinea hens are always great, one or two goats, that kind of thing. And you know what? They're favoring out so much better than most of the people that are surviving right now in these metropolis areas, which is probably why they're fleeing them in droves. That's what the news is telling us. They're leaving big cities in droves, and I don't know. I don't live in the States. I don't know if it's true or not, but this to me would make good sense of what I see now, because when you have corporate marrying political, you have fascism. And as a matter of fact, there's two fascists right on the state of on the stage of Congress, right on each side of the stage. And it's just amazing what has happened in the last three decades because of the blindness about being free versus other nations like China that have already recognized they're not free, which I think makes them ahead of the game, which is why wealth is fleeing west to east.
Well, the world has definitely changed. And I have to say that the people who have the right perspective are really, they're the people really, you talk about having your head up, you're really looking at the big picture and you're not lost in your own little microcosm. In a place like the United States, it's easy for people to say things like, oh, it's a free country. But if you compare where we're living right now to the way our parents lived, and the way our grandparents lived, it's no longer a free country. And people need to be proactive. And whether that means getting involved politically or getting involved in preparedness or getting involved and relocating, it's time to be proactive. Because obviously, the world as we knew it growing up no longer exists.
Pertaining to the first part of your statement there, though, I've always phrased it in a way where the world is a painting, but we live in a pixel. And, yeah. And most people, are that way. I think what I found in the 12 years of doing this, because we're now getting shadow banned. I don't know if you know what that is, but...
Oh, I knew exactly what that is. 3 years.
Yeah, but I'm proud of it. I'm sorry. It's a medal I'm wearing proud, because we've been bringing truth out, and about 3 weeks ago, all of a sudden, overnight, our viewing audience fell to about 15%, and I thought a whole bunch of people started hating me, and then I found out from somebody a lot smarter than us, because it's only my wife and I getting these words out and helping the people that we can. Anyway, they did it to their site, and they said, check your back door, and sure enough, YouTube did it to us, too. So you know, people like us, is it happening to you, too?
Oh, yeah. Well, in my case, it's with the search engines, and some of it's pretty subtle, but when you look, the only thing that's really been the things that saved us in terms of reaching the terminal moraine of search engine statistics was adding comments to the blog, adding graphics to the blog, and keeping our posts relatively short. I absolutely refused to do some of the things that the search engines were asking for, namely switching our writing style to write at a fifth or sixth grade level. I refused to do that. It's obvious that they're on the warpath. For anyone who has a conservative or libertarian bent, they are doing their very best to marginalize, demonetize, and inevitably demonize anyone who they disagree with. And in my case, not only was it the search engines, but I also, was the victim of the folks at the Southern Poverty Law Center targeting me. And that got picked up by a number of organizations, and journalists started using some pretty provocative nouns attached. They started referring to me as a supremacist. It's like, since when? I don't even believe in the concept of race.
Wow.
They started grouping me together with white nationalists and anti-Semites and racists, and none of which I ascribe to whatsoever. In fact, if anything, I'm an anti-racist. I'm an outspoken friend of Israel. But for them to try to whitewash me and smear me by throwing me in the same phrases with people who are, some pretty intolerant and intolerable people was really hurtful to me. And it's obvious that they're trying to pigeonhole me where I don't belong.
They're doing it to everybody who's up there in percentages that can actually make a change. Jim, I'm going to be honest with you. When I left one website and 3 years later started our somethingfeelswrong.com website and YouTube channel, I did it with this intent, okay? In under 4 months, we blew to the size around the world that they started shadow banning in under 4 months. That's how popular it got. We knew how to do it all along, but the thing is, listen, Vernon Coleman, I know some of these names. Michael Krieger just yesterday said he's shutting down Liberty Blitzkrieg. He says we're just not getting anywhere. I believe, and I agree with him, but people aren't angry enough yet. This is beyond a shadow of a doubt. If you're not stuck in any kind of delusion or fear, it's beyond a shadow of a doubt. But I don't think people are angry enough. I mean, Stefan Molinex just lost his YouTube channel. David Icke, regardless of what you think of him, the man is brilliant.
Really, if you look back to when they used Alex Jones as the trial balloon, and there wasn't too much static over that, and they just proceeded to do the same thing to anyone who was outspokenly conservative or libertarian or anti-communist or whatever. They began to marginalize and demonize all these people, and they came for Alex Jones first, and I'm just way down the list, but inevitably, they're going to try to silence every outspoken conservative and libertarian voice out there. And in the lead up or the run up to the November election here in the United States, I think it's only going to get worse.
I don't want to cut, but we're going to hit that before we close, and I know our time's limited, but I just wanted to say something. We're living in a world now, Jim, just because you're offended doesn't make you correct. And and that is exactly what, you see, right now with technology, and I really want to get this out before I ask you my final question. With technology right now, it's much easier to lie to 7 billion people than to convince them they've been lied to. And this is what we're facing, right? Because look at what, we are at the mercy, even people like us, Jim, we're at the mercy because we have to borrow their technology or I wouldn't even be talking to you.
Right.
So what chance do we have?
But for anyone who's captive to YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, all the usual suspects, don't count on those platforms being available to you in the near future. You may have to have a completely different platform of your own making, and you may have to even switch to a different form of media rather than video or podcasts to be successful, because they could very well pull the slats out from underneath you. So my prayer for you and all the other folks that are in the blogosphere and the vlogosphere is that you would keep apprised of the situation, develop alternate means of communication, and keep the faith, because we're in for some very trying times.
Where do you see this heading? What direction? And please take into account the upcoming election in November. In your views, describe what path we're heading down post-November, whether one, it's a Democrat victory, or two, a Republican victory. What lines of direction would either take? And that's the first official question, because we had a great chat. This has been great. Okay. This, everybody's such like a talking head. You know, one listen, today an expert will tell you tomorrow why what they said yesterday didn't happen today. I'm so sick of that. You know, and like I say, this was a genuine conversation between two adults, and to me this was valuable. But that one question I'm shooting at you, partner.
Sure. Well, you and me both, Barry, there. I've got to say that we're living in very interesting times. In the year 2020, we have already seen a pandemic. We've seen supply chain disruption. We have seen a stock market collapse. We have seen riots in the streets. And we've also seen the beginnings of a mass migration out of the big cities. I think we're going to see at least one more, possibly two more crises between now and the election. One will probably be a derivatives crisis and or banking crisis, and that will probably spring up around mortgage-backed securities, which if you look back to 2008, that's exactly what caused that financial crisis, and we're on the cusp of it again. So we'll either see a derivatives and banking crisis, and or we may see the outbreak of war in East Asia,
mm-hmm.
either between India and China, or between China and dissidents in Hong Kong, or between China and the independent nation of Taiwan. So buckle your seatbelts, folks. It's going to get very bumpy between now and the election. I frankly have no clue as to who might be the winner in the 2020 presidential election. All that I can say is that regardless of who wins, we're likely to see more chaos in the streets. We're going to see more intimidation, more posturing on the part of politicians at the city, state, and federal level. We're probably going to see some very rapid changes. If 6 months ago or 8 months ago, someone were to say, well, later this year, everyone is going to be locked in their homes and they're all going to be wearing masks. And if they don't wear a mask into a store, they're going to get tackled by security or the police and dragged away. 8 months ago, if you would have said that to most people, they would have said, you're crazy. That could never happen. Well, look where we are today.
Yeah, yes. I found learning for most adults is not really that difficult if there's effort. It's unlearning. Before closing, is there any new novels that are up and coming, and refresh all of our subscribers?
fiction book coming out in August. Okay. It's called The Ultimate Prepper Survival Guide. It's from Back Books under their Thunder Bay Press imprint. It's a London publishing company that took a little gamble, and seeing the success of my previous books, even though they'd never done a book of this sort for the American market, it's basically a big coffee table book format, and it's very detailed, also very heavily illustrated, since they mainly do coffee table books. But it goes through all the major threats that exist and provides some very practical, tactical, how-to, hands-on sorts of solutions for people to weather the storms of what's coming, whether it's another pandemic, whether it's a major earthquake, flooding. The Ultimate Prepper Survival Guide, that'll be in Costco stores starting the 26th of August. Folks at Costco worked out a sweetheart deal with a publisher, and they have an exclusive for a couple of months. So you can look for that in Costco stores starting in late August.
Okay, and people want to reach out to you. Is survivalblog.com still the best way, Jim?
Yeah, just go to my site. There's contact links there. And I want to encourage your listeners, especially any who are not familiar with Survival Blog, the entire blog archives that date back now almost 15 years, we'll be celebrating our 15th anniversary in August, are all free. They're all fully searchable. There is no limitations. There are no super secret members only areas. All those archives are there for the taking. Please dive deep and find what you need. Get your families prepared.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I remember that on our previous interviews up to five years ago, that you always had those for free on your blog. You can just go on over. There's nothing to sign up. You can just use it. And there's no personal information that people have to leave, anything like that, correct?
Oh, you could just dive in, print out what you want, and enjoy, folks. There's a lot of really practical, tactical stuff there. And the knowledge there goes far beyond my own. I have over 100,000 regular readers, and the letters and articles that they contribute have just a tremendous wealth of knowledge on practical skills for self-sufficiency. So please, folks, take full advantage of those archives. Again, it's survivalblog.com.
Jim, it was a pleasure, and I sure hope you'll take our third meeting together and put a link on your channel, and maybe I could actually help out a few more of your subscribers on our end, those that are thinking of actually voting with their feet a little bit more, because it's over 100 families that we've helped relocate, and we're very proud of that.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate you and your show and everything you do.
Thanks a lot. Take good care, and we'll stay in touch, okay? It seems every 6 months before an election we reach out.
All right.
All right. Bye-bye.
Sure.